Welcome back, everyone, to the lecture about applied bioimage analysis. This week will be about filters and image segmentation. I'm super happy that I got some slides from colleagues from Network of European Bioimage Analysts. I'm super happy that these colleagues shared them with me. So today will be about filters. What is a filter? What can we do with it? And what kind of math can we do with images? Afterwards, we will have a closer look in image segmentation, thresholding, watershed. I will explain you some algorithms, also the so-called connected components labeling algorithm. And the idea here is we could now have three lectures about these three individual topics, and there's a lot of details to tell, right? So, but I thought I will make one lecture introducing all of these concepts in a little detail. And so that you, after the lecture, immediately can do a full workflow for image segmentation. And then in the following lectures, we will recap some of the concepts again and again, especially, for example, we will talk in more detail about filters. But in order to give you the chance after just one lecture and building a fully functional image analysis workflow, that was a bit the intention behind here. And yeah, at the end, I will again show you how to apply the concepts. I will teach you now how to apply them in Fidji. So first of all, what is an image processing filter? An image processing filter is an operation on an image. I mean, it's as simple as that, as an image in and an image out. So you put an image in, with the pixels, there is something done, some mathematical operation, and there the results in a new image, which has different pixel values. So compared to the lookup tables we had last week, this operation filters, these operations really change pixel values in images. And what's kind of important to learn at the very beginning is that there is not the best filter for a particular scientific question. It's always a matter of trying. So it's like there are several filters you can use to solve a specific scientific problem, but you cannot immediately say which of the filters is the one to use. So it's like you try two or three out, you get a bit of feeling for what they are doing. And then after some time, you will learn that in some particular problems, you go this way, or in other problems, you go the other way. It's a matter of trying. And yeah, furthermore, even though sometimes it appears like filters do not do magic, it's just mathematical operation. And typical application examples would be something like noise reduction, artifact removal, contrast enhancement, or even illumination correction. So before we can actually talk about how to correct image quality and how to improve image quality, we should first have a look at what is actually disturbing images. What's the problem? What we can fix afterwards by applying filters to images. So noise is an important term here in this context. Noise is a general term for unwanted modifications to a signal. So it's kind of anything which can happen from the biological thing in the chamber or on the object slide in the microscope towards the file on the hard drive. So what can happen on this way? So first of all, the electronics which read out the pixels inside the camera into a digital signal, so the analog digital converter and the electronics behind, they may have some little statistical variations according to voltages, what is going on in these electronics, and this may have some influence on the signal itself. Furthermore, there is statistical variations depending on there's a number of photons arriving in the camera chip and how many electrons are going out on the other side. There's the so-called dark noise, which has something to do with the temperature of the camera. So there are, for example, cameras which have to be cooled massively in order to get this kind of noise down. Then there is shot noise. So how many photons are actually arriving from, for example, me sitting here in front of the camera? How many photons from the sun outside are actually arriving in the camera? And there's of course also a little variation, but what you also should kind of keep in mind when you think about noise, if you think about processes disturbing the observed processes, like biological and physical effects are also taking part. So there's, for example, in the microscope, it's just maybe a defocus. I mean, that's all kind of signal disturbing processes which you can summarize under the headline noise, right? Furthermore, biological objects are moving around like life, right? So ideally, we do live imaging. Ideally, our samples are still alive. And then there are many things happening, motion blur, diffusion, and stuff like that, which are disturbing our signal. So, but if you think about noise in a microscopy context, in the daily slang, and I like to write it down like this, the pixel intensity consists of the target intensity, so the infect number of molecules, for example, fluorescent molecules, producing signal inside your sample. Then there's background intensity, for example, coming from cells or from molecules out of plane. Then there's the camera offset. It's like every camera chip delivers a certain signal value, which is usually higher than the actual signal value. It's just because of electronics inside. And there is this thing we usually call noise, which is just statistical variation of pixel values. And effects of noise can be reduced by longer exposure times at the price of other effects such as motion blur and phototoxicity. Of course, the more light you put in, the longer you measure, the more your cells may suffer from your experiment, from your imaging time. So there's kind of, you have to keep the balance a bit between having a good image quality and not disturbing the system too much. And when we talk about noise as a thing in microscopic image processing, we usually talk about this. So we can actually assume that around this zebrafish eye, we can actually assume that here that's just water, that's just agar rose. There's kind of no actual variation of signal intensity down here. But when we zoom into the image, and if we also change the minimum and maximum signal intensity we are looking at, we see these local variations of signal intensities. And this is what most of the people usually refer to as noise in images. So why do we have to remove this noise? Why do we have to deal with it in order to work with the images further? So the problem behind is, if you take an image as it is, as it comes out of the microscope, and you, for example, apply an algorithm called thresholding, then the computer may think, oh no, there are thousands of tiny white objects in this image. So obviously, to the computer, it may appear like that, right? But if we blur the image first, which is kind of a step allowing us to remove noise, and apply thresholding afterwards, then the computer may suddenly see it as the four objects we were also perceiving. So this is kind of the necessary step we have to do in order to do a proper image segmentation, to get proper, for example, cell count out of images, like in this case shown here. And there are different noise removal filters. So I think we will come back to this in a later lecture where I will show more fancy techniques, which are kind of state of the art today. But if you think about really, really simple filters like the Gaussian blur filter and the median filter, starting from an original image, applying these two filters, you hopefully see already there's a difference between these filters, and that's what I said initially. In order to solve a scientific problem, in this case we want to remove noise from the image, there may be different strategies to deal with that, and it's not always immediately easy to say which one is the best strategy. So what we observe here, I hope you can also see it in the video, is we have sharper edges in the median filtered image compared to the Gaussian blurred image. Because the median filter is a so-called edge-preserving filter, so it's like a property of this particular operation on an image. And we can classify filters we can classify them in various ways. So in this particular case, I show here how a linear filter works. So thanks to Dominic White, who made this amazing visualization, we see here that this rectangle is a so-called moving window, which is moving over the image. And it's like frame by frame processing all these neighborhoods of individual pixels. And what it does, it starts from the center pixel and looks at these 3x3 pixels around and multiplies the intensity in each of these pixels, for example, with this 1/9. And then it sums up these values and puts the resulting pixel intensity into the result image. So when you see here for this particular frame, the value will be written here. Then it continues further. And you may agree that even though the variation here in this image is so high, so we see like noise disturbing our signal, you can actually get a smooth image out by applying such a mean filter. So the mean filter is like the Gaussian blur and like the median filter, a smoothing operation on an image to get rid of noise, to make the post-processing easier. So, and this is an example, because we can take every intensity in the image and multiply it with vectors, and we can kind of express it in a matrix like that, in a so-called kernel. That's why it is a so-called linear filter, because that's a linear multiplication of individual pixel values resulting in a new pixel value for the new image. What's also important to know for later on is that this operation we do here in between, so we multiply an image with a kernel, that's a convolution. So we actually say we convolve an image with a linear filter kernel in order to get a resulting image out. So that's the terminology we use here usually. And furthermore, there's also different kinds of filters, so-called nonlinear filters. So you can, so there are some operations you can do to these neighborhoods of pixels, which you cannot express as a linear multiplication of these individual pixels resulting in new ones. For example, you take these 9 pixel intensities out, you sort them in a list, and then you take the first one, so the smallest value, and you say, okay, this is the minimum intensity in this neighborhood. So you take the minimum intensity and you write it in the resulting image in this particular pixel, or the maximum intensity, which would be a maximum filter, or you take the median, for example. And also the variance and the standard deviation inside this 3x3 pixel grid can be seen as a nonlinear filter. Now you see we are already doing some biostatistics here, so this is just kind of a short detour towards this direction. So edge detection may actually be quite cool if you, for example, want to kind of get the actual sharp edges out of this particular image, and then you do a combination, for example, a median filter to get first bit rid of the noise, and then you do an edge detection filter to get an image out like that. But what I'm pointing to here is you can do this electronically if you are interested in, for example, the membrane around the nuclei. But you can also talk to your colleagues or to the microscopist in the lab. There are also you can also acquire images which contain this information already, and you may already see that there is a significant difference between these two things. So this is calculated. So that's why we do not see here in this particular region, when you look here, there is no edge between these two cell nuclei. So it's hard to get a line here, even though we know that between these two cells there is a membrane, or we can assume that there is a membrane. But there are actually markers you can apply, and then you can take images like this one, where you actually see the membrane. So depending on what you want to do further with that, you can do it electronically, but you can also do it in a biological, in a microscopist's way, let's say it like that. So that's the first part, filters. So how can we change the content of an image by applying a filter, getting another image out with increased contrast, with edges enhanced or stuff like that. But we can also do image. We can also do math with images. And for example, one very famous operation is the so-called subtract background. So you may see that the signal intensity outside here is actually quite black. And here, even though there are no nuclei, we can obviously see there is some increased signal intensity over here. In the further processing of these nuclei, if we want to, for example, count the nuclei here in the zebrafish eye, we have to get rid of this background signal intensity because it's disturbing the further processing. So there's an operation called subtract background, which does that for us. And if you want to understand a bit better what you can do here, you can also have a look at the background itself. So you can extract the background. That's a feature operation I may show you later. So you can, from the original image, extract the background, and then you can do background subtraction, as I have done here, or you can also divide by the background. And sometimes, depending on what you want to do, if you, for example, want to equalize signal intensities in different regions, the one or the other operation may be beneficial. I'm just saying that background subtraction is one thing, dividing by background is also an operation one should consider from time to time in order to improve segmentation results later on. So I've shown you this image earlier. If we want to count nuclei here in this image, it's super hard to differentiate these two nuclei here. When I look at these images, for me it's impossible, so how can the computer know? It might be hard to do so. So here you see an outline around the nuclei, and you see it's not clearly differentiable. But if you, for example, take this nuclear envelope image and you subtract it from the nuclei image, you may get an image which is easier to segment. So of course, the content of this image is different, and it's from some point of view biologically also wrong to do that. We cannot subtract one marker from another. the images have been taken with different wavelengths. So what does it from a physics point of view mean to subtract an image with one wavelength from an image with another wavelength? So it makes from a physics, from a biology point of view, maybe no sense to do that. But for an image processing point of view, it makes a lot of sense to do that in order to differentiate these nuclei better. So these operations are absolutely legal when it comes to cell counting, for example. However, I would not measure the signal intensity in this image afterwards, because it's not easy to explain what the signal intensity in such a subtracted image stands for. With that, we come to image segmentation. So image segmentation, from a terminology point of view, can often be divided into several steps. So, that's my personal opinion. I try to differentiate image segmentation and image labeling, or segmentation labeling, or something like that. So we look here at an original image, and we see it has different gray values. We see variations in the nuclei. So this is an image, how we get it out of the microscope. And then we do segmentation, which is just a black-white image, or we also call it a binary image. And if we then want to differentiate, so that's like the computer just knows there is nothing and there is something. And if you want to differentiate this something among each other, so if you want to say, okay, this is a different nucleus like this one, and they may, for example, have different numbers, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, then we do labeling. So image labeling takes a binary image, and we take a binary image and we label individual objects. Then we can, for example, draw the labeling onto the original image. And there are different ways of doing these things. Today we will show you a thresholding and how a binary watershed works. And later on, I think in 3 or 4 weeks, we will go the spot detection and seeded watershed way. And yeah, of course, we will do the machine learning way as well. So before we can generate these binary images or these binary masks, we should do some pre-processing in order to make it easier for the computer. So if you would try to segment this image, for example, with the thresholding operation I'm introducing soon, you may have a hard time. So what you want to do first, before that, is, for example, apply a median filter to this. You see already that's a bit smoother and there's not so much noise anymore. So that's noise removal. And you maybe also want to subtract the background to get some actual nice valleys between these nuclei. So this is kind of the processing we do first before we can actually do the image segmentation. And then afterwards we do thresholding. And thresholding means nothing else like we define a certain signal intensity, a certain gray value, where we say, okay, all intensities above are something and all intensities below are background. So something meaning nuclei or not nuclei, right? Here visualized in red, black in this particular case. And there are different algorithms for doing that. So for example, the O2 threshold, I will introduce a bit more detail, I think, on the following slide. When you think about thresholding in a scientific context, it is important to apply the same strategy to all images in your project. You should not take the one image and apply a median filter to it and then apply a threshold, and in the other image you do a Gaussian blur instead of the median and then you apply a threshold because it appears better to you. That would lead to a subjective result, right? We want to have an objective result, and then the strategy would be you pick a number of images which are representative for all the images you have. So let's assume you have 100 images you want to process, maybe acquired under two different conditions, so 50 images from the one condition and 50 images from the other condition. Then you pick something like 5 from the two conditions each, and you find a way, you find a certain image processing workflow for processing these 10 images. And after you are confident that in these 10 cases the algorithm works fine, then you apply the same strategy to all your 100 images. Ideally, you blind yourself during this process. So ideally, you don't know which of the 5 images are from the one condition and which of these 5 images are from the other condition to remove the last kind of impact of subjectivity in this case. So to remove yourself from judging the images. Furthermore, you should, of course, take a substantial number of images to train this strategy to reach some reliability. You should convince yourself and later on also the reader of your scientific paper or of your master thesis that what you're doing here actually makes sense. So what I'm saying here is, if you have a very long processing workflow, like you apply a median filter first, and then you do a Gaussian blur, and then you do a thresholding, and then you do a thresholding again and again, and something like this and that. If it's hard for yourself to explain why you have this long workflow, it may not be the best way of doing it. A short and easy to explain workflow is the goal. So ideally, you apply one filter for noise removal. You apply another filter for background removal, and then you do a thresholding. And then you can say, okay, this filter I apply to remove the noise, and this filter I apply to remove the background. And then I did thresholding because I want to differentiate this and that. So a short workflow is the goal, and an easy to explain one for yourself in order to convince others that your workflow is actually delivering a reliable result in this particular context. And of course, you should explain your strategy and you should cite the algorithms you used so that others can reproduce what you were doing. So if you, for example, look at the so-called OTSU's method for image segmentation, we see here a black-white image and we see outlined region which was thresholded, so like all the pixels below in black and all the pixels above in gray or white are differentiated from each other, and you see the result as an outline. And we now measure the variance in the pixels inside the contour and the pixels outside of the contour, and we plot it in this diagram. And you will see here that the variance is changing depending on which threshold I apply. So maybe I just go back. So this is approximately threshold 50, and this is threshold 105 or 110. And you see there is the contour is different, and it also means that the variance, the variation of intensity in this region and outside, and the intensity outside of the region is changing. So, and you can plot these numbers over the threshold, and you could then, for example, argue, okay, if the variance is crossing, that might be an interesting point to actually apply this particular threshold. And Mr. Otsu, when he developed this algorithm, Professor Otsu actually, was thinking, okay, you can actually go one step further and also include the size of the objects into the determination of the threshold. So what he was suggesting 40 years ago is we apply all thresholds between the minimum and the maximum intensity in the image, and we measure the variance inside and outside of the contour, and we multiply it with a weight which is determined by the number of pixels in the contour. So this is the number of pixels of below the threshold, and this is the number of pixels in the image. And so we can weight the variance inside and outside and calculate the weighted sum variance. And the weighted sum variance looks like that. And if this measurement becomes the lowest, so that should be somewhere like here, we take this as the threshold of this particular image. So this is an objective way of getting a good threshold out of an image. So it's not like me sitting in front of the screen saying that at this image I apply a threshold of 100 and in the other image I apply a threshold of 130 because the segmentation looks the best. This is an automated way of doing that. This is a kind of an objective method from a histogram or from an image itself, determining a reproducible threshold to threshold the image in a reproducible and objective way. So, and of course, whenever you use such a method, you should then cite the method properly. So here, for example, one could say, okay, we segmented the cell nuclei in the images using the OTSU thresholding method, OTSU 1979, and as it is implemented in Fiji, Schindelin et al. 2012. So this is the part which brings us the reproducibility that others could do the same method to their images if they want to reproduce our experiment. Furthermore, if you realize whatever thresholding method you apply to your data, they are all not working. They all look like, ugh. So you do thresholding to your image and the outline looks like that. And you can try whatever you want and it does not become better. So what do you do then? So you can do another thing, which is which I call over blurring. Maybe there are better terms for that. So you blur the image a lot with a huge kernel, not like 3x3, but a big kernel averaging all the signal intensities around, and you get this blurred image out. And this blurred image is much easier to segment, right? So that would actually be a strategy to get rid of the influence of local variation. You can do a segmentation like this. But what I also have to say here is, if you would later on want to post-process this data, for example, if you want to measure the signal intensity in this nucleus, you should do this again on the original image. You should not analyze the further process, the blurred image. You should go with the contour from the blurred image to the original image in order to do a measurement. Furthermore, just a comment for now, we will have a look at this later. Think about, is it scientifically correct, or is it the best way of doing it? You do a thresholding on an image, so you determine a threshold depending on the signal intensities in this image to afterwards measure the signal intensity in this image. Does it make sense? Are there any risks here if we take a threshold which is determined from signal intensities in order to measure signal intensity? Just think about it for now. Pitfalls. So I was already talking a bit about earlier, so let's just summarize that for now. Thresholding has some pitfalls. So what you should never do, from my point of view, you should never do it. Apply a manual threshold to your images. So you should never sit in front of a screen, or if you sit in front of a screen and you try different thresholds like 100 or 120 to get a good segmentation out, you should always ask yourself, why am I doing this? Why am I sitting here judging my image, judging a threshold? So if you can prevent that by, for example, using an algorithm like Ozu's method or by any other thresholding algorithm, use the thresholding algorithm. You, as a human observer, should not influence the thresholding, this threshold finding when processing images. It's not reproducible what you are doing while sitting in front of the screen. You can, it's hard to reproduce for other people how you are judging this image. So it's not reproducible and it's not objective, obviously. Furthermore, choose a thresholding algorithm, as I mentioned earlier, and use it for all of your images. Try to not switch methods within your set of images from the same or from different conditions. Try to always use the same method. Furthermore, there is no perfect method. If you find a threshold algorithm which processes 450 of your 500 images nicely, then it's good. If the other 50 images are segmented in a crappy way, you can find a way to get around this just by using statistics later on, or for example, identifying images automatically which were not properly segmented. But if you start searching for a thresholding algorithm which can process all images properly, you may waste a lot of time. Just keep in mind, there is no perfect method, and you always have to live with the fact that there will be images not being segmentable. As long as you can if you can process most of your images, you are fine. And keep that in mind. Searching for a perfect method may end up nowhere. The next step after thresholding, or maybe it's a part of the segmentation, let's say it like that, is refining mask. So let's assume we had this original image, we were doing some thresholding on it, and this is the result we get out. So the outer outline looks actually okay-ish, but first of all, we have black holes inside. And if this is an embryo, I mean, the images is called embryo.tiff, right? If this is an embryo, I would assume that the inside belongs to it. So from that point of view, this binary image here is wrong. There are no pixels inside which do not belong to the embryo. Furthermore, there are some individual single pixels outside, which are also kind of described as embryo, and that's like wrong in this particular case. And there are post-processing operations you can apply to your images. In this particular case, an operation, for example, is called fill holes, or there's also something called binary closing. They are a little bit different. In this context, they might do the same to fill these holes. And then there's another operation called binary opening, which allows you to get rid of these little, I call them islands, of these individual pixels outside. They are gone here, this particular image. So you could again search for a perfect segmentation thresholding algorithm, which directly goes from here to here, or you accept that the thresholding algorithm is not perfect and you post-process the thresholding results by refining masks with binary operations like binary closing and binary opening. And in order to understand these binary opening, binary closing, these operations a bit better, there is one operation I would like to introduce first. It's an erosion. So we start from a binary image like this. We have 5 times 5 pixels. And there are some of them are white, and we apply an erosion, which kind of erodes the, let's assume this is an island. And now there is like the coastline is eroded, right? So after some time, after a heavy storm, the island becomes smaller and looks like that. If you think about it from a mathematical point of view, let's assume that all the pixels in black have the value 0, and the pixels in white have the value 1. What filter is it we apply to this image to get out that image? You have heard it earlier. It's, I mean, of course, erosion, but there's also another filter, another mathematical filter I described earlier, which does the same thing. Just think about it. Furthermore, the opposite operation is dilation. So we start from a single pixel, which is dilated and becomes, after the dilation, bigger like this. So like you extend the outline of a white area in a binary image with the dilation operation. And furthermore, dilation and erosion both exist for different neighborhoods. So we call the neighborhood of a pixel like this, and I think they also have names. Yeah. So the 8 connected neighborhood, so that means every pixel has 8 neighbors in 2D, is also called the Moore neighborhood. And the 4 connected neighborhoods, so every pixel has 1, 2, 3, 4 neighbors, is the von Neumann neighborhood. Maybe these names are not so super important for processing in images later on, but these neighborhoods were named for people, for mathematicians, for computer scientists of the early days, and that should at least be mentioned. If you combine erosion and dilation, you can actually use them to correct outlines, to get rid of little disturbing artifacts of outlines. So let's assume our thresholding algorithm resulted in this binary image. And if we apply now an erosion, almost the whole thing is gone. Every pixel which only has white neighbors stays white. Every white pixel with only white neighbors stays white. And every pixel which has a black neighbor becomes black. So this is what erosion in this context is doing. And if we apply a dilation afterwards again, we get a binary image out, which looks almost as the initial image, but the disturbing artifact pixels are gone. So we have a simplified outline in this particular case. You can later try that out on bigger images. In this individual small pixel images may be a bit too trivial. So, and let's look at it if we, for example, start with the binary image I showed earlier today. So we start from this image and we apply an erosion. So we erode the coastline from these 4 islands, and we do it again, and we do it again, until the first one is almost already gone, right? So this is what an erosion is doing. And a dilation is increasing the size of these islands until they start fusing, right? At some point you have one big blob, which is white. And you can combine them, for example, by dilating first and then eroding afterwards. That's what I just told. That's the so-called closing. You can also do the opposite by applying erosion first and dilation after, and that's called opening. And you can do this even more complicated. So here again, you see the closing operation, which is dilation and erosion. But you can also think of, okay, I do dilation twice and then erosion twice and I get this result out. I can also do erosion twice and dilation twice and I get this result out. And there are quite some ways to go from such an image, from such a binary image, which shows thousands of tiny white objects, to such an image, which is actually just showing 4 white images. So what I'm saying here is that you had earlier the chance to apply a Gaussian blur to an image before thresholding to get a better thresholding result out. but you can also, after thresholding, correct the image in a way that the segmentation result looks good. So you always have different ways of achieving the same goal. That's what I'm saying here. furthermore, to cut connected objects, the watershed algorithm is a very powerful tool. So let's assume we started from this image, did some binary erosion, dilation, whatever, and we arrived here. We can apply the so-called watershed algorithm in order to make these cuts here, right? So it can again, the algorithm just looks at this binary image. We can again make gaps here in between and then erode the image and also get a good result out. And I would like to explain a bit more in detail how the watershed algorithm works. So let's assume we start at our binary image. And from the binary image, we generate a so-called distance map. The distance map is the following. For every pixel in our original binary image, we measure the distance to the next black pixel. So for example, for any black pixel in the image, the distance to the next black pixel is zero. And zero becomes in our new image black. Yeah? So we see that here in the region where the pixels are black, also here the pixels are black because the distance to the next black pixel is zero. And as soon as we come to the border of an object, for example, from this pixel here, the distance to the next black pixel is one. And one we can express with a gray value, which is not black, but which is dark gray. And the more we go to the center of our white object, the wider, the farther, the more far it is to go to the next black pixel. And this is why it becomes here more white or a brighter gray, let's say. And this is what a distance map is. And if you look at this image as a map, you can actually see it as these white regions here are valleys, and the black regions around are mountains. And you can then express it like that. And let's now do a little experiment. So my teaching assistant for today prepared a little experiment. So thank you, Robert, for doing this. We are looking here at these valleys, and I'm now Robert is now putting some green fluid over in this valley and some red fluid in this valley. Maybe so that's like corresponding to the image here. Maybe I increase the zoom a bit more. And now it starts raining. There's water falling from the sky, and you will see depending on where the water is coming down. It goes in different valleys. It goes either to the green valley or to the red valley. Yeah. So depending on where the water is hitting the ground here in this region, it goes either to the left or to the right side. And this little hill here in the middle, hopefully you can see my mouse pointer, this little hill here in the middle is a so-called watershed. It divides the water into two regions, going to the left side and going to the right side. And filling up these two valleys. And if you continue putting water in here, you reach the point where one of the valleys would spill over to the other valley. And in this particular situation, you take kind of a protective wall, put it in between them, and then afterwards you can further increase the water level in this valley without the waters mixing. And this additional wall we see here, which I just put in this little experiment, this additional wall is what the watershed algorithm does. So we have the water in the valleys with different colors, and then it starts raining and the level is increasing. And at some point we have to put these additional walls in here in order to keep the waters with the different colors from the different valleys distant from each other. And this is what the watershed algorithm is actually doing. And from that point of view, we can say, okay, we can differentiate objects, but it is purely derived from a binary image. So if this in the original image have really been two different cells or two different blobs or whatever, is not clear. And the algorithm does not know, but it gives its best by applying this particular technique in order to build these additional dividing walls here between these potentially two objects. I'm just saying The algorithm just takes the binary image into account. It does not look at the original image. So it has nothing to do with biology. It just comes from the shape of the binary image. So furthermore, let's now assume the thresholding. We had some pre-processing before the thresholding. After the thresholding, we did some post-processing to get cool, good-looking binary images out. And now we want to differentiate different objects from each other. This is when the so-called connected components labeling algorithm comes into play. So we start with a binary image like this one. And we start at any white pixel. The algorithm searches for one white pixel somewhere and puts a number one into this pixel. And then it starts looking in the neighborhood of this pixel for other pixels which are also white. So directly touching neighbors, connected components. And also puts a one there. And it does it again and again and again until it doesn't find any more white pixels which are touching any pixel with a number one. And then it searches again for another white pixel, which is somewhere in the image, and puts a two in there. And then it follows the same strategy to fill up the whole white object with twos. And then it does it again with the number three in the third white object. And at some point, it will not find any white pixels anymore. And then all the other pixels are set to zero. So the result of the connected components labeling is a so-called label map, where object number one has pixels set to 1, object number 2 has all pixels set to the value 2, and object number 3 has all pixel values set to 3, and the background, so where there is no object, becomes gets the signal value 0. So this is a label map. And yeah, interestingly, the maximum intensity in this image corresponds to the number of objects in this image, so it's 3 in this case. And if you think about label maps, you can actually visualize them in different ways. So that's looking back to last week. So if you, for example, apply a lookup table in gray, you will see that the object number, so object number 0 is actually background, right? It's black. Object number 1, which is also almost black, cannot so nicely differentiate from the background. That's why I would recommend applying a different lookup table. And there's a lookup table, for example, in ImageJ Fidji, which is called Glass Bay. It has from every intensity, from intensity value number 1 to 2 to 3, high differences. So it's like not two similar colors are next to each other. And this is why we can actually nicely use this lookup table for visualizing labeling maps, for visualizing every object in our image in different colors. So that's the part for now. So we have gone through actually quite some operations. So I showed you what filters are and what the difference between linear and nonlinear filters is. I showed you image thresholding and segmentation and what's the difference between segmentation and labeling. We also just had a look at connected components labeling, and I also showed you what kind of additional image math operations you can do on images. And in the next part, I will show you how to do these things in Fidji. See you soon.